So, hello everyone. I'm very pleased and honored to welcome Professor Bruce Walker here at IRCAM. Actually, Bruce will be a jury member of Claire Richard's PhD defense tomorrow, but for the moment, he will present us the work he has done and he is doing at Georgia Tech University and the so-called sonification lab. So, Bruce, I give you the floor.
All right, thank you. Let me know if there's any challenges in hearing me. I generally project fairly well. Thank you for inviting me here. It's exciting to be in Paris again. I'm going to tell you a little bit about how we do work in my lab. For those of you who don't know, I have a very large lab as a single faculty member. These are not all currently here. These are all the PhD students that have come through my lab. But generally speaking, I have several PhD students at any one time, and I have many, many, many master's students at any given time. It's a little bit of an army. So we try to do this interdisciplinary research that brings together technology and psychology and perception all together. It doesn't get done, right? These are the PhD students who really do all the work. I just take all the credit. That's my job. That's what I tell them. My job is to bring in the money. Their job is to spend it, and then I take all the credit. So that's how we do. But I have great colleagues and friends in the faculty, both at Georgia Tech and around the world. So I'm a professor. I've been there for over 20 years. I have a joint appointment in psychology and computing. That makes me a little bit country and a little bit rock and roll. I can get that together. I wear many hats, and I'm part of a lot of different groups by now. But the main one is my lab. I think of myself as a researcher, and really what we're trying to do is application-inspired basic research, which is what you'd call Pasteur's quadrant, right? This is trying to change the world, but to do so in a systematic way. I teach a lot of classes from design and engineering through sensation perception all the way up to research methods. And it's kind of fun to know that I have some time in my day to do some entrepreneurial stuff. For example, we built a system to detect whether someone has COVID based on changes in their voice. We also have a system that we're working on now that diagnoses skin cancer using deep learning, and it also has a component in it that uses sonification, which is kind of fun. You can ask me about later. All right. So in my lab, we have this this duality, this joint appointment in psychology and computing, which is unique, partly because at Georgia Tech, psychology is in the College of Sciences, so it's a science, and computing is in computing. So they're very different schools in different colleges in different corners of the university, but somehow we make it work. My students come from all over campus. And if you don't have so here's some students, a psychology student, a computing student, another computing student who Vincent happens to be blind. He's subsequently graduated. I have another student who's blind in my lab. If you don't have a lab jingle, you should get one. Everyone needs to have a lab jingle. Here we go. But sometimes you want a different mood, so we go with this. Or when the BBC comes for an interview, we do this one. All right. Okay, so you get your logo, you get your jingle, you get your students, you get all of this set up, and you get on with doing some work. Okay, so how do we do work? The kinds of projects that we do, we have a mix of evolutionary and revolutionary. So the evolutionary work is where you know what the existing literature is and you try to make an incremental improvement. The revolutionary is when you think outside the box, like whoever thought that you could use sonification for skin cancer diagnosis, right? This has never been done. So we try to mix those for a couple of reasons. One is because science has to be evolutionary. It has to be a progress of ideas. But you also need these transitions, these major steps, these revolutions. I guess I should. Yeah, France is the home of the revolution, right? So, you know what I'm talking about. I like to do these long-term, 5-year, 6-year, 8-year projects with potentially high impact. Very, very interdisciplinary, transdisciplinary, where we can learn about the basics, advance that sort of foundational knowledge, and publish in journals that are basic to the field, and then also make applications that involve typically multimodal and novel user experiences, right? It's not just enough to make technology. You also have to consider how this is going to be used. If we're making an AI system for skin cancer, we have to factor in privacy. If we're making a system to help older adults drive more safely, well, we have to figure out how to get their trust and their acceptance. So the ethics and the societal cues have to be part of our work. All right, so here's Yoda, one of our favorite characters. And we like to say in our lab, fear not the rabbit hole. What do we mean by that? Well, you know what a rabbit hole is. When you get, it's a Thursday night and it's 10 o'clock at night, and then suddenly you spend 2 hours on the internet, you know, kind of learning about something weird. In research, we often see the start of a rabbit hole, and you know it when it's there. You say, "Oh, this is going to take me in a weird tangent." We like to go down those roads. We like to try those things out because that's where the revolutionary stuff happens. So we'll come back to Yoda, but we'll see an example of it, you know, one rabbit hole that went down, and it was quite interesting. Today, I'm only going to give you a little brief overview of some of the projects we've done, just as an example of how we do work. These are all projects that are largely completed, although each of them has a new generation that's coming along, and I'll tell you about that. The first one is the System for Wearable Audio Navigation, or SWAN. We like acronyms in my lab, so we come up with some pretty good acronyms. My students wanted to call this the System for Wearable Audio Navigation and Knowledge, but then it would be SWANK. So I didn't think that was really the best acronym, so we stuck with SWAN. Accessible Aquarium Project and the In-Vehicle Assistive Technology Project. Let's jump in. So SWAN addresses this problem of wayfinding and getting from place to place to place if you're blind. We generally say, instead of blind, we say people who cannot look or cannot see. Because that's certainly people who are blind, but also people like firefighters who are in a smoky building in the middle of a fire, or soldiers in the dark, in the forest. These are people who are situationally blind. Surgeons, doctors who are in the middle of a surgery, right? They can't be looking up, they need to focus. So these are people who cannot look or they cannot see. So getting from place to place and then knowing what's around certainly involves these accessibility applications, but also tactical applications, lots of potential users for this kind of technology. All right, so as I mentioned, we're going to start from the beginning and apply our rigorous methods. We start with understanding the users and what they need to do and what they need to accomplish. For this, we're going to use the typical interviews, focus groups, surveys, all of the background research that is necessary. And sometimes we ask questions that our participants don't really know the answer to, right? So we'll ask a blind person, if you went to an aquarium, what would you like that experience to be like? They're like, well, I would never go to an aquarium because I'm blind. All right, so we sometimes have to get them to imagine. But this points out the boundaries and the limits of some of these research methods. Sometimes you have to use new or different research approaches to ask and answer these questions because the user group and the topic area are sometimes new to each other. We often work with people with vision loss, whether it's blind or low vision individuals, or whether it's firefighters or others. So we have a very extensive pool of advisors and people that we connect with. All right, so let me step back and say, when you're trying to figure out where someone is and then help them get from place to place to place, if I wanted to go from here to the hotel, I need to know where I am now, where the hotel is, and the path between here and there. This is pretty challenging at every step, which is why we take 5 or 6 or 7 years to do these projects, because at every moment, every step, we anticipate some problem. We anticipate a rabbit hole. For example, GPS. We all know GPS, Global Positioning System, and we all know that it's messy. Maybe in the city, it's accurate to about maybe 3 or 4 meters. Okay. Well, if you are walking down the sidewalk and you're off by 3 or 4 meters, you're in the road. If you're a blind person, that means you just got hit by a bus. Not good enough. So how do we make GPS better? We're just a little lab, right? We're not going to make GPS better. Well, it turns out that we have to solve these problems or else our systems are never going to be used. So we had to go down this whole rabbit hole of taking multiple GPS transceivers or receivers, putting them together and merging the data and getting a super GPS signal, which was much better, had much better accuracy. So all of these different kinds of problems we tackle and do what we can. We blend GPS, inertial navigation, infrared, radio frequency, computer vision, and visual odometry, all these other kinds of sensors that get fused together to give us a very good sense of accuracy. And when we're talking about the person's location, we're talking about pose in 6 degrees of freedom. So their X, Y, Z location, but also their roll, pitch, and yaw, right? Because if someone is facing this way and we say walk forward, right, we need to know what that means. Or if they're looking this way, but their body's facing a different way, and we say, you know, what you're looking at now versus what you're looking at now, we need to know their head and their torso and all of it. All right. We also need to know how they're going to communicate with the system. This is human-computer interaction, and so we need to think about speech, obviously, keyboards, mobile kinds of things like twiddlers, auditory menus, whatever method is possible. We have to think about the dynamics and the context of use. For example, if we have a wayfinding system, and I'm a blind user, and I say, and I'm talking to my system, hey, Swan system, take me to the bank machine. Take me to the ATM. That system will totally understand that. Everyone around me will totally understand that. So now everyone around me knows that I'm going to the bank. Okay? That may be a security problem for someone who's blind. Right? Or, hey, system, take me to my doctor's office. The rest of the world doesn't need to know that's where you're going. Right, that's a privacy concern. So between safety and privacy, we've got to figure all this out. So these are that's the level of sort of consideration that we try to apply to all of these systems. All right, we have to sometimes build new things, prototype them up. You know, you guys know here at IRCOM about trying new things and building electronic devices. We also need to figure out how we're going to convey information to the user. So the display of information, this is the user interface. We have to think about things like speech versus non-speech and you know, whether people can customize whatever they're feeling or listening or smelling. Even things like headphones versus bone phones, we'll talk about that in a moment. Well, the system for wearable audio navigation, as the name suggests, is a purely audio augmented reality. So it's a sound system that helps you get from place to place to place and at the same time know what's around you. If there's a bench or a toilet or a bank or a Starbucks, all of those things are around you. The first thing we have to figure out is what types of information do we need to display and how are we going to do that? We start with audio beacons. These are sounds that convey where you are and where you need to go. So if I need to go to the door, I can't go straight to the door, right? I need to make a path from here to here, and there'd be a waypoint and then I need to turn, and then I need to go to the next waypoint, and the next waypoint, and the next waypoint. So I'm going from waypoint to waypoint. That's what the navigation beacons do. They form this path that you can walk along. Then there are objects and obstacles. Obviously, there's a table, there's a door, there's an office. These are things in the way that I need to be aware of. Surface transitions. If there's a flat surface and then there's stairs, or there's carpet and then there's tile, these are surface transitions that someone may need to know about. Sidewalk and then road, or sidewalk and then grass. And then we have locations, for example, a lecture hall or an office or a street intersection. All of these things we can use. In this case, we used spatialized audio earcons. These are sounds that are non-speech, somewhat musical, and they have a lot in common with the thing that they're trying to represent, but it's not an exact kind of sound, all right? And then for annotations, we can use recorded speech or text-to-speech. For example, if there's a little dip in the sidewalk, and when it rains, that little dip becomes a puddle, we want to be able to tell the person, you know, they're walking down the sidewalk, hey, pay attention, when it rains, there's a puddle here. That could be an annotation that someone else made 3 weeks ago. I'm walking along, I hear this, I'm like, well, it hasn't rained in 2 weeks, so I'm going to keep going. Or, oh, it rained last night, so maybe I will cross the street. All of this, again, is a systematic attempt to figure out what type of information do we want to present and how do we do it. Okay. Once we build this system, we have to do a thorough evaluation. This is an example of, pardon the low resolution pictures, it's a capture from a video of one of our blind participants and one of my graduate students walking around campus in front of our psychology building, trying out the system. We have to evaluate the technical aspects, like the location tracking. We have to evaluate how well someone can perform their task of getting from place to place, how well they learn about their environment. We also assess things like their movement speed. If someone is walking this slowly, right, that's not really an effective system. They need to move at the pace of life, right? In my lab, we also generally have a three-pronged, we're in France, is it this one, right? This one, okay. three-pronged approach, right, where we performance, preference, and affect. Performance, how well can you perform the task? Preference, how well do you like it? Is it, you know, satisfactory? And affect, how does it make you feel? So if we build a system that allows people to perform a task and they think, yeah, it's okay, but it makes them feel empowered, it makes them feel free, it makes them feel independent. That's important. We want to be able to measure all those things. We've built systems for automated driving where people could perform the task and they didn't really want to change anything, but they would never use it because they felt afraid. Right? We want to measure that. Comfort and satisfaction are part of this, you know, this affect or emotional considerant. All right, so in terms of safety and comfort, when we asked Anicio here, our participant, he said, I can perform this task, I can get around, I know what's around me, I see this, I can, you know, sort of see, he says see, but he recognizes when there's a surface transition. The system works great for him. And we said, okay, well, would you use this? And he said, no, never. Oh, come on, man. He was with us for 4 years developing the system. Like, yeah, it works great. So why won't you use it? He said, well, you're using headphones. You're covering my ears. What? Oh, it was one of those, okay, a professor moment when you just like want to go back into your office and close the door and cry. It's so silly because he is blind. When we put headphones on him, like here, we've taken away his next best sensory system. So he said, hey, it's great, works in the lab, but I would never use it in the world. Okay, so Fine. We'll talk about that in a second. We said, at least try it. So he tried it, and we had a bunch of people try it, and this little graph on the bottom shows the yellow path here is a path that people are supposed to walk, and it's about 200 or 300 meters long. The other colored paths are the actual paths that people walked, and there was no, it was on a football field or a soccer pitch, artificial turf, with no markings. So there was no context cues. People had to use the audio only. And you can see that most of them did pretty well, and that was using sounds that we determined were good. You also see the same path in yellow here on the right, and other paths in colors indicating participants were getting lost, and those are what we would consider bad sounds. So as part of our evaluation, we're testing the effectiveness of the different designs. All right, so even though we know what would work and what wouldn't work, we have our designs, Anicio says, I'm not going to use it. Well, we got a problem. Our whole system was designed using spatial audio, using headphones, so virtual spatial audio. We needed to figure out some other way of conveying virtual spatial audio. Two sources are necessary, something like speakers, something like headphones. Well, one of my students suggested, well, why don't we put little speakers on the person's shoulders, right? And then their ears would be open. Okay, that's fine, except when they turn their head, that breaks that system. Okay, well, what if we had a hat? And then we had little speakers on the hat, so that when they turn their head, right, we've got the speakers, but they could still hear. Technically, okay, but it looks dumb. And when we're asking about satisfaction and whether people would use it, they're like, don't make me look dumb. I'm a blind person and I already am noticeable. The last thing I want to be is more noticeable, right? So we've got to find a way to convey stereo without making it obvious. So this is where we get to bone phones, bone conduction. By now, this is 10 or 15 years later, we all know that bone conduction works in a way that's very similar to headphones, but it leaves your ears open. You can vibrate the skull, whether it's here on the mastoid bone or in front or on the top of your head. And if you have two of them, you can create a stereo sound. This we know. At the time, we didn't know. And in fact, I said, let's try bone conduction. We got some bone conduction headphones from the manufacturer, in this case, Temco. We basically hacked them and turned them from mono to stereo by adding, you know, changing the connector. Because there's a wire going to the left and a wire going to the right, but they were all connected to a single mono plug. Well, we cut that off and, you know, turned it into a stereo plug, added a wire as well. We plugged it in to the headphone jack, and it worked. Stereo bone phones. So I went to a conference and talked about it. And all of the audio engineers at the conference says, "Oh no, you didn't. That's not possible." I said, "Try it." They're like, "It doesn't work. It can't work. It's not possible. Physiologically, it's not possible." I said, "Try it." They're like, "But for 70 years, we've known it's not possible." I said, "Try it." And they put it on and they tried it and they're like, "This can't work." So then I had to figure out, why does it work? So I had a student go down a rabbit hole for 5 years to figure out how bone phones can be used in stereo. And the short story is that there's a guy, now about 100 years ago, Tondorf, who did these measurements of bone conduction on audio. And he measured the speed of sound in bone. But his measurements were in dry, dead cadaver skulls. And I don't know about you, but my head is not dry and dead, right? Saturday mornings, sometimes. So all of his measurements were very precise and very wrong. But we've used them for 100 years. So we had to go back, and instead of measuring the speed of sound in dry, dead cadaver skull, we measured the speed of sound in living undergraduate heads. And it turns out that the speed of sound in living head, with skin and hair and cerebral spinal fluid and brain sloshing around and all of that, the speed of sound in that context is about the same as the speed of sound in air. The speed of sound in dry, dead cadaver skull is 10 times faster. Well, the argument was, if I vibrate on the right-hand side, the vibration's going to go to my right ear. But the speed of sound is so quick in the skull that it's going to zip over to the other side so quickly that I don't get any interaural time difference. Okay? So Tondorf, with his measurements, proved that you could not do stereo with bone conduction. We showed, through our measurements, that you could, because there's enough of a delay that you get some interaural time differences. So 5 years later, one rabbit hole later, we now show that you can get stereo through bone conduction, and you can buy headphones, aftershocks, and stuff on the market that sound just like stereo headphones. All right, so that's just an example of where we go with that. While we're at it, as part of this rabbit hole, we went through a whole process of understanding the way sound is propagated through the head, and we did some computer modeling, fluid mechanics, finite element analysis. This is hard, right? So you have a model of the head, but it's not just the skull, it's all of the other tissues that have to be combined. And then you've got the fluid model, which is your brain and cerebral spinal fluid. And if you know about this kind of modeling, historically, it was hard to put a physical finite element model and a fluid model together. So we had to figure that out. So now all of a sudden we're mathematicians. Great. So the United States Army was interested in this and funded us to do a bunch of this work. And you can see that we did some very interesting modeling. I spent hours and hours in our MRI machine getting scanned. And then we would build models of the cochlea and everything else in between. Okay, so we go down this rabbit hole, we understand and we do computer modeling, we do behavioral analyses, we do perceptual studies, and we build these systems. All right, so the Swan system was an example of one of these projects in academia where you go down all these rabbit holes and you explore and you study and you write papers and you go to conferences and you convince people to try bone phones and all that good stuff. And at some point, you've squeezed all the science out of it. And there's not much more to do except turn it into a product. Take it onto the market. But I'm a professor. I'm a nerd. Right? That's not what I do. So many times these projects sort of stop and they never get out of the lab because they're more academic projects. That's a problem in academia in general that I want to continue to work on, but that sort of happened with Swan. Recently, however, there's been interest, so we've picked it up and technology has advanced, so now we can very quickly build a newer version of this with much smaller hardware that we're calling Swan 2.0. We can use fiducials, these are the indoor markers, we can use virtual reality for testing, we can use gaming methods and techniques, we can build this in Unity. So rebuilding Swan 2.0 is much, much easier with the tools that we have available now. We have a demo system, works great. It works great outdoors, works great indoors. Audio, we've already done all the design for the last 10 years, so it came together quite nicely. Now the question is this yet another academic project that's going to sit in the lab, or do we take it out into the market? And we're gonna think about taking it into the market. Here's an example of, we build a very quick, we take a floor plan and we very quickly build a a virtual reality version of this so that you can visualize where someone is. They don't see this, they just listen as you move along. All right. Let me transition to a different project. This is the Accessible Aquarium project. Very different concept, but the same general approach. Okay. So, oh, I went too fast. All right. Pretend you didn't see that. All right. So imagine you're going to an aquarium, and the Georgia Aquarium, when it opened, was the world's largest aquarium. People from all over the world come to see this aquarium. You go and visit. All right, so close your eyes, if you will, and go ahead and close your eyes. And now I will show you the picture. Keep your eyes closed and enjoy this picture. Wait a minute, you're blind. All right, you can open your eyes. The experience is visual. This wall of glass, it's a foot thick Lexan, and it's 135 feet wide and 40 feet tall. When you go there and you see the whale sharks and you see all of the things that are in the ocean, it's amazing. It's visceral. It makes the hair stand up on your arms. It's like unbelievable. Unless you're blind, in which case you got nothing. How can I give that visceral hair stand up in your arms experience to someone who's blind? How can they see this and be like, wow? Or how can they not see it and experience it somehow and get that wow experience? All of these different kinds of amazing visuals have to somehow be translated into a computer that can then convey it somehow to the blind person. Well, presumably, if someone is blind, then sound is what we're going to use. Sound has been used in exhibits, aquariums, and so on, typically as sort of muzak, right? Mood music. And it's just to give you the setting. But it's not actually conveying anything about the dynamics of the exhibit, right? So what we need to do then is to have a handle on the dynamics. We need to track the creatures and the critters. Let me stop and say, Mother Nature invented camouflage and has hundreds of thousands of years head start on us. Our job here is to defeat camouflage. Let me also say, we can't touch the fish. We can't put an RFID tracker on them. We can't tape a fiducial on them. We can't spray paint them, right? So the only thing we've got is computer vision. We're back to camouflage. All right, so here's a difficult challenge. Once we figure out how to defeat camouflage, and once we figure out how to track the fish in this 8 million gallon tank of salt water, then we're going to use the location, the velocity, acceleration, other sort of global variables to drive a dynamic real-time soundtrack. So we've got to track the fish. We've got to convert that into, we've got to, you know, do some computer vision stuff on that, some classifiers and motion detection algorithms and so on. Then we've got to convert that into sound, and then we've got to ship the sound from our computer to our listener in real time. That's hard. I keep saying that's hard because all of this is hard. And we've got a bunch of hard stuff glued together. Well, hand wave, I'm going to let the computer science experts solve the hard problems and I'll just take the credit. The design of this we can start with, and we know that there are what we call background fish, right? Like all the little fish. And then there's the celebrity fish. So we've got background fish and we've got celebrity fish. People go to the aquarium to see the celebrities, right? The whale sharks. So we want to differentiate those in our sound design. So that's great. Okay. We're going to convey the dynamics of the scene using a mixture of speech and music, and it has to really tell people what they're going to experience, especially if they can't see it. All right, I'll point out this is an interdisciplinary team with architecture and computing, music, psychology, and it took us many years to do all of this. Fish, we started with, we knew that we were going to capture videos of fish. So we started with fish in a fish tank, and then you get your tracking server. We throw it into Max to do some audio stuff. We tweak it and we ship it out to the listener. At the start of this project, we were bringing together researchers who were doing tracking of other things, in this case, ants. So we said, well, let's start with some ants, some video of ants that have been already tracked. So we know the XY location of these ants, and then figure out how we can turn that into sound. So here's one example of what we can do. And I'll talk over this. This is just one version. There are three ants. One of them will appear in a second. So we have three instruments. One is a trumpet, right? One is a piano, and one is a hi-hat. Left is left stereo, right is right stereo. Up is high pitch, down is low pitch. Okay, it's a very simple mapping, right? And then we have a sort of a very simple musical generation of method. So you hear the hi-hat climbing up the right-hand side. This one's going away, so we lose the trumpet. And I don't know if we have this left-right stereo working, but... All right, so you get the idea. We can change this and do jazz versions, whatever we want to do. So we start from there, and then we have to progress towards an aquarium, so we set up a fish tank. So it's interesting, we set up a tropical fish tank in our lab. If you have a fish tank in your lab, it's a fish tank. It's decoration. If you have a fish tank in your lab and you point a camera at it, it's now an animal research facility. And you need to go through all of the permissions to get an animal research facility, just because you have a camera pointed at your fish tank. Okay, oops. So you can see that we start to do this. This looks kind of cartoonish, but remember, this is 15 years ago. Now this would be very simple. We would do this with YOLO or whatever, and boom, we'd have a classifier that could figure out what kind of fish we're talking about. We made it easy on ourselves because we intentionally got blue fish and yellow fish and stripy fish, orange fish, to help the classifier, right? Again, this is a long time ago, but the fish are doing their thing. We're identifying them and figuring out where they are and mapping that onto sounds. We needed to make the sound design somewhat pleasant, but also very easy for people to interpret. It can't be super sophisticated because a kid has to go to the aquarium and get it, right? So we go from there. Then eventually we get to the point of doing live tracking in the aquarium. This is a beluga exhibit. Then we started to think, well, we don't want just a beeps and bops and cheesy music. We wanted to be able to give this different musical styles. So we brought in a lot of composers and musicians. This is Laurie Anderson. She came in and she looked at the belugas and jammed and played, right? She interpreted what she was seeing in her style with her musical kit. We brought in drummers, we brought in cellists, we brought in all kinds of people, and then we can make essentially a Laurie Anderson musical skin or a style that would interpret the belugas to a listener in, and it would sound like she was there playing for you. So this is all the different kinds of iterations that this project went through. we got to look at different shapes. In this case, lots of fish. This is the aquarium that is right at the entrance to the gift shop. You know, you go through the aquarium facility, and the last thing you do is you go through the gift shop because they want you to buy stuff. And so this has to sound like a gift shop, right? It has to be kind of calm. It has to be like, oh, this was a good experience. This is the last time we've got you before you go into the purchase action. So we want people to linger a little bit. We want them to get a sense of what's going on. So we had to design the tracking and the acoustics, all of that, to make this reasonable. And I'll point out that it may or may not be obvious what the fish are, and it may not be possible for you to close your eyes and know exactly what's going on. So long as generally speaking, there's a correlation between the music and the fish movement, so that people say, oh, I get it, right? This is computer-generated music that's driven by the fish in real time, and now I'm going to go buy something in a gift shop. Right. All right. Our next step is jam session. So the aquarium generates a track or a set of instruments, and then we can have human members of the band, if you will, to jam with it. And this was a fun project. We now have a robotic drummer at Georgia Tech. It's a fully robotic drummer, and we have other human and non-human instruments involved. So there's lots of interesting things that can go. All right, so I'm gonna change gears again and very briefly touch on one third and final project before I wrap up here in a few more minutes. This one is a very different kind of project. It's less about entertainment, and it's more about safety. The in-vehicle assistive technology project is an effort to help drivers who have had a traumatic brain injury. If you are a soldier and at the time you went to Iraq and there was a roadside bomb, your truck got blown up, you were in the hospital, you come back, you may have had a traumatic brain injury, you may have had all kinds of challenges, you go through a rehabilitation process. Or even if you are a person that's in a motor vehicle accident or something like that, we have this center called the Shepherd Center, and they rehabilitate people. People could spend 6, 8, or 10, 12 months in rehabilitation. They could have these brain injuries. At the end of that, they want to get on with their life. They want to get back to normal. And in America, one of the things that really signifies being back to normal is driving. You need to get back in your car and be able to be independent again. So we want to be able to provide people who still have this residual brain injury with the ability to drive in a safe way and give them their independence back. All right, so that's the idea. Here's someone who wants to get back in the vehicle. Driving is very much a perceptual and a cognitive task, and you can't stop paying attention. You have to always maintain your vigilance. We found that many of the patients who wanted to get back to driving were certified, and the Shepherd Center doctor said, sure, let this person drive again, but they still had memory issues or perception problems. They had hand-eye coordination or reaction time. Some of them even had things like hemispheric neglect, when you basically ignore half of your world. When you're driving, half of your world is a problem, right? we had people who would zone out. They would stop paying attention. So we had to develop some kind of a system that would serve as an electronic driving coach and help them maintain their awareness. So we had it. We had to design a solution that would help them maintain their speed or check their mirrors or maintain situation awareness. First thing we had to do is figure out what the individual driver was good at and what they had problems with. So we had this evaluation from the rehabilitation specialist. Then we had a bunch of sensors to figure out what they were doing. So in the car, we had multiple cameras tracking them and figuring out where they were looking, where they were paying attention, and so on. And then we had a multimodal HMI, an interface using sound and speech and vibration and so on. To help them get through their day. So one example of this is Freddie. He went for his driving test and sat in the car with the driving instructor after he had recovered from his injuries and drove fine. Right? However, after the driving instructor left, Freddie would continue to drive and he would go through a stop sign. He would go through a traffic light. He would get in an accident, right? And the question is, what's going on? Well, it turns out that when there's someone there, he was always conscious about that and he was paying attention. But when there's no one there, he would zone out. He would lose attention. So we needed to keep him in the moment. We needed a driving buddy. And so we did a number of things to help remind him to check his mirrors. We developed a little tune that they learned, bum, 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 and it was stereo spatial so that the idea was to check your left mirror, bum, and then your middle mirror, bum, and your right mirror, bum. And so this bum, bum, bum tone, little tune, they would learn to map to the action of check your three mirrors. Periodically, we would just say bum, 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 and they would check their mirrors. They would get in. We could also use GPS and GIS and other methods to figure out what's around them. And we could say things like, Nicolas, what's the price of gas at the Chevron? And we would just say that. And when you're driving, you would say, oh, at the time it was like $1.20 or something. We didn't care about the answer, right? The idea was to get the person to look outside of the vehicle, to become aware. We could say, how many white cars are there around you? Oh, okay, there's one, there's two. Oh, in my rearview mirror, I see what three. So we're getting them to survey their environment. And we could check to see if we wanted to, if they were correct, but we didn't really care. It was just to get them outside of their head, outside of the car. So between all of these systems, we had this multimodal interface. We had all these little tips and tricks. And the bottom line was giving them their independence back. All right. A couple other things just to wrap up so that we can be done on time. In my lab, we take on these big projects. And we're able to roll in a lot of students as part of the effort through what we call terching. This is teaching and researching. Many of you have taught classes or been in classes where there's a class project. And for many, many class projects, they are essentially throwaway projects. So you sit in the class, you have a team of three or four students, and you do some project. And at the end of the semester, you do your final presentation, you write your report, everyone's like, oh, great, 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 and then it gets forgotten. And even the next semester, another group might do the exact same project again. And the teacher's just like, oh, okay, fine, right? So these throwaway projects aren't helping anyone. We try to make everyone in these classes part of the incremental research endeavor, so we're blending teaching and research. A couple other fun things that are notable is we have a new facility that we call VRlandia, and as the name suggests, it's all about it's a space, it's a collection of equipment, but more importantly, it's a community. It's not as grand as ERCOM, not yet, but it's the same kind of concept, right? You have a space, a set of equipment, and a community to do research in a particular topic. In this case, it's VR and AR. And we give the students, undergrad and grad students, all the skills and tools to try new things out. And so that's great. And I'll also point out that we can carry this work forward with these large, long-term interdisciplinary projects because we take advantage of what we call an R&D studio course. These are teams of two students, typically interdisciplinary, that are brought together to work on a project. The idea of this studio class is that I will say, okay, you want to work in my studio, you know what I do. We do multimodal, HMI, HCI, user interface, human-robotic interaction. This is the kind of stuff. Here are the projects, you know, here's the 10 or 15 projects that we want to work on. And students sign up. Once they sign up and they give me the resumes, I choose the students and put them together on teams. The idea is that if you go to work for Google, you know what Google does, right? You apply, you get a job, you start working at Google. When you get there, you don't say, you know what, I'd like to work on that project. No, your boss, your manager says, you're going to work on this project, right? So we take that same approach. The students come into our lab, into our studio, and then we say, well, you've got background in computer vision, you've got background in research methods, we're gonna put you together, and you're working on this accessible Safari project, or you're gonna work on this emotion project, or you're gonna work on this skin cancer detection system. So the studio project is kind of fun that way. We also do a lot of community service. We have a radio show and a podcast that's kind of fun. And fairly recently, we've started this new project called Access Core, where we are basically teaching our undergraduates to assess all of our courses to see where they are not as accessible as they could, and then work with the professor to fix these courses. All of us professors want to make our courses accessible, but we don't know how, or we don't have time, or we don't have the skills. We're taking away all of those excuses. We're going to bring an army of students who are trained to come and help you. I've got my slide deck. I give you my slide deck, all of my PowerPoints for the entire semester, and then you're going to give it back to me fixed. And at the same time, you're going to teach me how to make sure that my subsequent slides are more accessible. Okay, so in summary, this is my last slide. We're going to embrace evolutionary and revolutionary projects, take all the time we need to, and do things in an interdisciplinary, transdisciplinary way, really understand our users, ask those blind people if the headphones might be a problem, like we're trying to do that. Novel user interfaces, often using sound, haptics, we do smell as well. Try to delight your users, consider trust and ethics. This is important, Turching. And above all, jump into those rabbit holes with both feet, because really, those are the things that are kind of the most fun. All right, with that, I thank you.
Thank you very much, Bruce.
Yeah, we have a couple of minutes. If there's questions or discussion.
There are questions or comments.
From here, and I'm not sure if people online have an opportunity or whatever.
If someone, yeah.
Thank you for your talk. I have a question about the first project, the Swan project. On one of the last slides, you showed navigation in a corridor. So I was wondering which type of 3D modeling, acoustic modeling, you were using to promote the sensation of the acoustics, of the room acoustics.
Yes, so remember, this is 10 or 15 years ago. So what we were doing was we had a very basic 3D surround sound model, and then we just had a very basic room reverb that we applied. And when you're walking down the hall, it doesn't have to be precise. We just need to know that there's a door there, and a door there, and a door there. So kind of sort of in that direction was good enough. So we used headphones with spatial audio, often we use gaming audio because it's pretty good. A little bit of reverb to give a sense of space. We didn't even change the room model for different spaces. So if we were in a large room like this or a corridor, we just kept the same reverb because people learned. It was pretty straightforward. And you could be walking down the hallway and hear. And that represented door, door, door. And it didn't matter if the door was wooden or metal. We used the same sounds. So it was very kind of cartoony to convey what was going on, generally speaking. And a blind person, as they're walking, they still have all their mobility skills. So if you say, oh, there's the door, okay, they can get there. And once they get there, they can figure out where the door handle is and so on. So that was kind of the level. We didn't need to be super precise in an acoustic way because we had to solve the larger problem of make it good enough.
Are there any questions or comments? Well, actually, I've got one little question on that purpose, because how do you tackle with, in this sonification and sound design projects, how do you tackle with a very fundamental problem, I think, is the learning curve of what you propose to the blind people or the users? Because, for instance, the deviation lines you showed could be two steps of the same person's learning how to handle with the ear cone,
yep.
they listen to, or how do you deal with that problem?
So there are a couple of things involved there. The first one is we want to make the sound design as walk up and use as we can. So make the sound design as obvious as possible. In addition, so for that, we have obvious sounds, right? That's a door. We have different sounds for various locations or features, transitions. Right? That's like an example of an ear con that is kind of sort of conveying a carpet to tile. So we design the sounds to be fairly obvious. The next piece is training. So we are expecting that these are blind people or firefighters. They're going to use these systems, so we provide a training approach. What you saw in that figure was people using the system for the first time. Some of them got it immediately. So that tells us that we can make sort of good sound design. What you didn't see was also a study where we trained people, including people who were really bad at the beginning, and we train them and give them practice, and then they get pretty good at it. If the sounds are good, their navigation is pretty good at the start, and they get a little bit better. If the sounds are bad, their navigation can be bad, and they get much better, but they never reach the same level as if you had the good sound design. So sound design matters, training also matters, but you have to have them both. One final comment on that is sound design is hard, right? And so here's a little audience participation. I'm walking down the hallway, doorway, office. What should the sound of a toilet be? Walking along, office. Anybody want to? Flush. So do the onomatopoeia. Do it for us. Shh. Shh. Okay. Most of us probably thought the same thing, right? Well, it turns out that blind people do not want to hear the sound of a toilet flushing all day. So the obvious design is not necessarily the best design. So we can make, whoosh. I think that's American toilet. I don't know. The different sounding flushes, but people think it's gross, right? Like, I don't want to hear that, right? So we had to think about what's obvious and would lead to good performance, but then also what is going to allow people to enjoy the use of this system over the course of hours, days, weeks, months, years. So sound design matters in a really fundamental user-centered design kind of way. What else?
Thank you. Good conclusion of the talk. Are there any additional comments, or I think it's time for lunch. Oh, Nathan, you want to add?
Thank you very much for your talk. It was very nice. I have just a small question about the second project you talked about. Mm-hmm. Honestly, I really liked the sounds you created for the fish, even mm-hmm. though I'm not blind. So I was just curious if you had any feedback from blind users on the topic.
Absolutely. And as I pointed out earlier, we measure performance, preference, and affect, right? So we measure whether people can tell us, where is the fish, right? Can they perform using this as an interface? And we assess whether we are effective in that. We also ask them what their preferences are, but we also ask them about their emotional connection. And all of those kinds of feedback we collect and use that to improve the interface on all those different levels. I know I'm standing between you and lunch, so again, I'll thank you very much for having me.
Thank you, Bruce, again.